welcome, everybody, to the Informed Secular Minds podcast. I am Cory, and with me today is Maris. You can hit him up at youngathlon399 on Twitter and Periscope. You can follow myself on both of those fine platforms at dopinephrine. Now, this is our first episode since we lost Nathaniel Walters from the show. Nathaniel and I started the program 8 episodes back, and we are going to miss his intellect and commentary. He was just a brilliant person, a fine atheist activist, somebody who brought a cogent view to everything that we talked about. He decided to depart from the program for some personal reasons. And so we are continuing on without him, but we wish him the best of luck in all of his future endeavors. Today, though, we've got some exciting things to unpack. We've got some really great topics to discuss. Maris is joining for the first episode next week. We're not quite sure what we're going to do yet. We've got some interesting prospects to consider. And if you follow ISM_podcast on Twitter, you will be the first to know what we decide to do and all of the upcoming show news. You can also follow ISM_podcast on Periscope for some future broadcasts. Though we are not broadcasting on Periscope tonight, unless our good friend Dawood jumps in and does it as he has done in the past. The chat is open, guys, so we hope that everybody will come and engage with us live for the next 2 hours. You can listen to the show on Blog Talk Radio /informed podcast, and you are welcome to call in if you want to talk to us. If you have a comment or a question, you can call us live at 646-564-9551. You can talk to both of us live on the air. You can also get the podcast on iTunes under Informed Secular Minds. You can subscribe there. Leave us a review if you happen to be on iTunes. Hit us up and give us some feedback. We always do appreciate that. Now, the first topic that we want to talk about tonight is atheists in government. This has been something that's long been an interest of mine. I'm a bit of a political junkie. I think Maris is as well. And I came across a couple of articles that I definitely wanted to cover. I don't know how aware everybody else is of how atheism impacts politics. Now, on previous episodes, we've discussed the Establishment Clause of the Constitution, which provides for the separation of church and state. That is to say that the government is not allowed to dictate a state religion. It's also widely considered to give protections to people of all faiths or of no faith. In the United States, which is a secular nation, you are allowed to believe in whatever god or gods you choose. The government's not allowed to tell you that you are not allowed to hold those beliefs. They're not allowed to dictate your rights based on your beliefs or lack of beliefs. It also protects for those who hold no beliefs, those who are non-believers when it comes to theology. When we started the show, that was something that we were very much implying with the title, The Informed Secular Minds. The United States is a secular country. We are involved, those who are involved with the show are all, so far, American citizens. And so we generally talk about this through that perspective, through the eyes of American citizens. I wanted to talk a little bit, just to start off, about a case from the late 50s, early 60s. There was a bookkeeper named Roy Tricasso, who happened to be an atheist. He refused to declare that he believed in God in order to serve as a notary public in Maryland. This was the requirement at the time. In order to serve as a notary public, one was required to declare publicly that they were a believer in God. His case went all the way to the Supreme Court, and in 1961, the court ruled unanimously for Mr. Tricasso, saying states could not have a religious test for public office. If that sounds familiar, it should. The lack of a religious test for public office is in the federal constitution. However, all these years later, this was about 55 years ago that this case happened. Maryland and 6 other states still have articles in their constitutions saying people who do not believe in God are not eligible to hold public office. The Constitution of Maryland, Article 36, reads in part, "Nor shall any person, otherwise competent, be deemed incompetent as a witness or juror on account of his religious belief, provided he believes in the existence of God, and that under his dispensation, such person will be held morally accountable for his acts and be rewarded or punished therefore, either in this world or in the world to come." This shocked me. I've been engaging on these issues for quite some time. I've always been very interested in both politics and religious beliefs. I did not know until rather recently that this was still on the books in Maryland. The constitutions of Arkansas, Mississippi, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Texas all include language prohibiting people who do not believe in God from holding office. This is stunning. The idea that a state government would decide, regardless of what the federal government says, that they would consider somebody to be less competent to hold a administration position, somebody who is doing paperwork, essentially, even a bureaucrat in some cases, should be somehow declared incompetent just because they don't believe in God, is a gross overstep of the state. Mississippi's Constitution says, "No person who denies the existence of a supreme being shall hold any office in this state." North Carolina says, "The following persons shall be disqualified for office. First, any person who shall deny the being of Almighty God." This was put first. Let me put this into a bit of perspective. Article 6, Section 8 of North Carolina's Constitution talks about the disqualifications for office. And it says, "The following persons shall be disqualified for office. First, any person who shall deny the being of Almighty God. Second, with respect to any office that is filled by election by the people, any person who is not qualified to vote in an election for that office." That makes total sense. "And third, any person who has been adjudged guilty of treason or any other felony against the state or the United States, or any person who has been adjudged guilty of a felony in another state that also would be a felony if it had been committed in this state, or any person who has been adjudged guilty of corrupted or malpractice in any office, or any person who has been removed by impeachment from any office and who has not been restored to the rights of citizenship in the manner prescribed by law." So if
wow.
you're treasonous, if you've committed treason, you can't hold office. But that's the third most important thing. The first is whether or not you believe in God. It's more important based on if we were to take this as being ranked, it could be in no specific order. But it says, first, any person who shall deny the being of Almighty God is disqualified from holding office in North Carolina. Second, if you're not allowed to vote, you can't hold the position for which the vote is being held. And third, you know, if you've committed treason, then it's a bad idea for you to be allowed to hold public office. Second and third, I understand. That makes total sense to me. But to first say that any person shall be considered disqualified from holding office if they deny the being of Almighty God is antiquated, to say the least. That is a gross sentiment. And if anybody from North Carolina is listening, talk to your senators, talk to your congressmen, and get that changed. That's gross and outdated, and is no longer something that we should have on the books.
So they mentioned God four times in North Carolina's Constitution. I find it crazy that they're kind of like, well, if you're a felon or guilty of treason, yeah, you can't hold office. But more important than that is whether or not they believe in the Almighty God. That's the most important thing here. Cory, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Let's talk about these. Let's talk about the four times that God is mentioned in North Carolina's Constitution.
Okay. So we got in the preamble. Let's see. "We the people of the United States of North Carolina, all grateful to Almighty God, the sovereign ruler of nations, for the preservation of the American Union and the existence of our civil, political, and religious liberties, and acknowledging our dependence upon Him for the continuance of those blessings to us and our posterity, do for the more certain security thereof and for the better government of this state, ordain and establish this Constitution. There's one. We got Article 1, Section 13, religious liberty. All persons have a natural and inalienable right to worship mighty God according to the dictates of their own consciences, and no human authority shall in any case control or interfere with rights of conscience. Say so help me God. And fourth, of course, no atheist allowed in office in the first place.
I love this preamble. It's so submissive. It's this, they go out of their way to again and again talk about how the people, just for the right to sit down and write a constitution, they're grateful to Almighty God. They make sure to call Him the sovereign ruler of nations. They start their constitution by immediately ceding rule to their idea of God. It doesn't say which God they're talking about, but given what we know in North Carolina, I think we can probably assume it's some version of Elohim, Yahweh, or Jehovah. They're not real specific about which God. They just make sure to let everybody know that He is the sovereign ruler of nations, and that their constitution must, of course, come second. Pennsylvania's constitution contains. Go ahead.
Sorry, I think which God they're referring to is heavily implied.
I would agree. I think there's enough here for us to deduce which God they're talking about. it's interesting to me that they just refer to Almighty God without stating, you know, Jehovah, Yahweh, Elohim, one of those. Now, Pennsylvania's constitution contains no prohibition, but does say that no one can be disqualified from serving in office on the basis of religion as long as they believe in God and a future state of rewards and punishment, a direct reference, of course, to heaven and hell, a future state of rewards and punishment. This isn't a legal document that is meant to defend the rights of the people of Pennsylvania, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So they're not directly prohibiting it. They're just saying that you can't be disqualified based on your religion. It doesn't matter what religion you are, but you could potentially be disqualified if you believed in no God. That is to say, we would rather you believe in some different God than to believe in no God. That is more dangerous to us than believing in a God that is in contest with our own. Now,
so
Article
if you worship Odin, you're more qualified to be government official than you are if you don't believe in any God.
Precisely.
As long as it's one God, they don't care what it is. You just have to have a theology of some sort, because that makes
precisely
sense.
Precisely. Yeah, they would rather have somebody who worshipped Odin than somebody who said, I believe in no gods. That's the Pennsylvania Constitution. Article 6 of the United States Constitution says no religious test should ever be required for federal office. And the Tricasso case that we referenced essentially made these state constitutional requirements of faith unenforceable. But that doesn't stop states from occasionally giving it a try.
This is from the New York Times, December 6, 2014. The state bans have been invoked rarely since 1992, according to legal experts. In South Carolina that year, Herb Silverman, a math professor at the College of Charleston, who is an atheist activist, was denied a position as notary public. His case went to South Carolina Supreme Court in 97. He won. Let's see here. In North Carolina, after Cecil Brothwell, a writer, won a seat on Asheville County Council in 2009. His opponents tried to invoke the state's constitution atheist ban, the state constitution's atheist ban, to deny him his seat. They soon backed down. Organizers with openly secular see the bans as evidence of the quiet bigotry and discrimination by many atheists, agnostics, humanists, and free thinkers. They point to a poll conducted by the Pew Research Center this year showing that nearly half of Americans would disapprove of if a family member married an atheist. That's astounding.
That is astounding. And I'm sure you have as well. I've met several people who are coming into this problem right now. I know a few people personally who are either just in a romantic relationship or are talking about getting married to somebody who is an atheist, and their religious family members are deeply concerned that that they would make such a reckless decision. Pew also found that 53% of Americans polled in April said they would be less likely to vote for a presidential candidate they knew was an atheist. Being an atheist was found to be the least desirable trait a candidate could have, worse than having cheated on a spouse or having used marijuana. In Maryland, one state senator has already been hearing from constituents who want the atheist ban removed. Jamie B. Raskin, the Democratic Majority Whip, is also a professor of constitutional law at American University. In an interview, Mr. Raskin said the constitutional provision was inconsistent with Maryland's history as a refuge for Catholics fleeing persecution and a haven of religious tolerance. He foresees an attempt to remove the atheist ban as part of a broader overhaul and modernization of the state constitution. But the next opportunity for a referendum on whether to hold a constitutional convention in which changes could be made is not until 2020. Paging through a copy of the state constitution, he said the atheist ban was only part of the flotsam and jetsam that needed to be wiped from the document. It's an obsolete but lingering insult to people, he said.
A lingering insult. It needs to go away. In the breathtaking pluralism of American religious social life, politicians have to pay attention to secularists just the same as everybody else, Mr. Raskin said. If a Mormon can run for president and Muslims can demand official school holidays, surely the secularists can ask the state for some basic constitutional manners. But there may be some resistance from legislators who see the effort to remove the clauses as sensible, but politically and symbolically unpalatable. Christopher B. Shank, the Republican minority whip in Maryland Senate, said while he believed in pluralism, quote, I think what they want is an affirmation that the people of the state of Maryland don't care about the Christian faith, and that is a little offensive.
So this guy has boiled the issue down to it's not about, justice. It's not about everybody having equal access. It is clearly, it must be. What other possible explanation could it be than that Maryland Democrats want to affirm that the people of Maryland don't care about the Christian faith? He's actually arguing for the promotion of Christianity on the state level instead of the inclusive nature that secularism provides. This is dangerous, and we would be remiss if we didn't say that if the state of Maryland had in their constitution a clause that suggested that Protestants or Methodists or Buddhists or Muslims or Catholics were not allowed to serve, we would also be offended by that. This isn't about tearing Christianity down. It's about allowing for room for all of the other faiths. We are a secular nation. We have the melting pot of various cultures and beliefs or lack of beliefs. All of them, based on qualification, should be judged as competent for holding office regardless of what they believe or don't when it comes to matters of spirituality or religion. Now, I wanted to make this a little topical. We all remember just a few months ago when the election cycle was in full swing, and the DNC's emails were hacked. There's been a bit of back and forth as to who hacked them. The federal government is fairly convinced that it was somebody in Russia. Donald Trump and some of the people on the right say that it's not them. I don't know why it matters, but they're saying that it must have been somebody other than the Russians. I guess that somehow makes it better. I'm not sure why they're going against what the CIA and the FBI and the president are saying, but that's neither here nor there. Among the nearly 20,000 internal emails from the Democratic National Committee released by WikiLeaks and presumably provided by the hacker Guccifer 2.0, is a May 2016 message from DNC CFO Brad Marshall. In it, he suggested that the party should get someone to ask Democratic presidential candidate Bernie Sanders about his religious beliefs. And I've got the email here. This is from Marshall at DNC.org, dated May 5th, 2016. Subject line, no shit. I love that. The body of the email reads as follows. I'm assuming he means make. All of the grammatical and spelling errors are intact. It might make no difference, but for Kentucky and West Virginia, can we get someone to ask his belief? Does he believe in a God? He had skated on saying he has a Jewish heritage. I think I read he is an atheist. This could make several points difference with my peeps. My Southern Baptist peeps would draw a big difference between a Jew and an atheist. The email was sent to DNC Communications Director Louis Miranda and Deputy Communications Director Mark Postenbach. It's unclear who the someone in this message could be, though a member of the press seems like a safe bet. A request for comment sent to Marshall was not immediately returned. They updated the story a little bit later, and Marshall emailed to say, I do not recall this. I can say it would not have been Sanders. It would probably be about a surrogate. We have asked them who that surrogate could possibly be. It doesn't matter, ladies and gentlemen, who Marshall was talking about. This demonstrates that as recently as last year, atheism was a label that was seen by at least some in the Democratic Party as politically damaging to an opponent. The idea here is, regardless of who you're talking about, whether it's Bernie Sanders or some surrogate or anyone for that matter, that it's not about the issue. It's not about arguing about their qualification for the job. It's about planting a seed of doubt. And apparently the best way to do that is to label somebody as an atheist. The plan here seems to be that if they can make someone look like an atheist, that person will lose credibility in the eyes of the public. There is no good reason for this. If you're listening and you can provide us with a reason why an atheist is less capable of serving as president or a notary public or a judge or a jury member or any other civic position, if you think that all other qualifications being equal, a Catholic and an atheist are somehow differently qualified to serve in the real-world job of administration, I encourage you to please give us a call and let us know why you feel that way. 646-564-9551. Let us know why atheists are less qualified to hold office than theists are. Pew Research.
I would love to hear somebody argue that point.
I would too. I would be very interested in figuring this out, in breaking this down. We talked about Pew Research a little bit. They were the ones who did the research on what would be the least appealing label that you could ascribe to someone, who's less likely to vote for a candidate. Somebody who's an atheist, according to Pew, is less likely to be voted for just because they're an atheist than someone else. Pew has done some other studies. You may remember this from a couple of years ago. It was a bit of a news story. Every 7 years, Pew does a big poll to study the faith beliefs of Americans. They did it in 2007. They did it again in 2014. Presumably, they'll do it again in 2021. The idea here is to determine the demographics of America when it comes to religion. And what they have found is that practically all religious groups are shrinking, while those who say none, atheists, agnostics, or nothing in particular, is rising. In 2007, the amount of Christians in America was 78%. In 2014, it was down to 71%. In that same period of time, atheists, agnostics, and nothing in particulars went from 16% to 23%. That's 7% in 7 years, in either direction. 7% decrease for Christians, 7% increase for nuns, people that have no religious affiliation. 7%, that's fast. That's a pretty significant rise in a 7-year period. Given that this was three years ago, we're probably on track to be around a quarter of the population now. If we were at 23% in 2014, it wouldn't be unbelievable to think that a whole quarter of the American populace, as of the beginning of 2017, are either atheist, agnostic, or declare nothing in particular when asked what religion they subscribe to. When we break this down by age group, 35% of millennials declare none when it comes to religious questions. 35%. 9% of U.S. adults say they were raised without religious affiliation. Half of them are now religious. So half of them were raised outside of religion but joined one later on. 18% were raised Christian or another religion and now have no religious affiliation. So twice as many. 4 people have become nuns from Christians as have become Christians from nuns. And I don't mean nuns like people, you know, women that dress in black and white and have cool hats and can fly. I mean people that answer none when they are asked what religion they are a part of. Nuns are more heavily concentrated among men than women, but the growth of the unaffiliated has not been limited to certain demographic categories. A rise in the share of unaffiliated has been seen across a variety of racial and ethnic groups, among people with different levels of education and income, among immigrants and the native-born, and throughout all major regions of the country. Nearly 2/3 of atheists and agnostics are men, and the group also tends to be whiter and more highly educated than the general population. The share of U.S. adults who describe themselves as Christians has been declining for decades, but the U.S. Congress is about as Christian today as it was in the early 1960s. This is something brand new. Pew just published a new study. It was yesterday or the day before when the new Congress took office. They wanted to have a look at the 115th Congress and how that body was made up when it came to religion. The share of U.S. adults who describe themselves as Christians has been declining for decades, but the U.S. Congress is about as Christian today as it was in the early 60s, according to a new analysis by Pew Research Center. Indeed, among members of the new 115th Congress, 91% describe themselves as Christians. This is nearly the same percentage as the 87th Congress, which was in 61 and 62, the earliest years for which comparable data are available, when 95% of members were Christian. We've seen the needle barely move in the last 50 years. Congress is still overwhelmingly Christian and is Christian at a much higher percentage than the rest of the population is.
Is it ironic that the people who are religious are managing to stay in power, though?
One wonders.
Among the 293 Republicans elected to serve in the new 115th Congress, all but 2 identify as Christians. There are 2 Jewish Republicans, that's Lee Zeldin of New York and David Kustoff of Tennessee, both who serve in the House. Democrats in Congress also are overwhelmingly Christian at about 80%. But there is more religious diversity on this side of the aisle. The 242 Democrats in Congress include 28 Jews, 3 Buddhists, 3 Hindus, 2 Muslims, and 1 Unitarian Universalist, as well as only 1 member of Congress to describe herself as religiously unaffiliated. And that's Republican Kirsten Sinema, Democrat from Arizona. In addition, all 10 members of Congress who decline to state their religious affiliation are Democrats. And you've got to assume that a number of them are atheists and uncomfortable with revealing that. Like the nation as a whole, Congress has become less Protestant over time. The total percentage of Protestants in Congress has dropped from 75% in 61 at the beginning of the 87th Congress to 56% today. During this period, the share of Catholics in Congress has gone from 19% to 31%. With the Catholics.
Fully 2/3 of Republicans in the new Congress, 67%, are Protestant, while 27% are Catholic. The breakdown between Protestants and Catholics is more even among the Democrats. 42% of the Democratic members are Protestants and 37% are Catholics. The analysis finds that some religious groups, including Protestants, Catholics, and Jews, have greater representation in Congress than in the general population. Jews, for example, make up 2% of the U.S. adult population but account for 6% of Congress. Other groups, including Buddhists, Mormons, Muslims, and Orthodox Christians, are represented in Congress in roughly equal proportion to their share of the U.S. public. The group that is most notably underrepresented is the religiously unaffiliated. This group, also known as religious nuns, now account for 23% of the general public, but just 0.2% of Congress. As noted above, Kristen Sinema of Arizona is the only member who describes herself as religiously unaffiliated. Now, we can draw a conclusion from this. Either there is a correlation between being religious and wanting to serve in Congress, or there are plenty of other atheists or agnostics, or whatever label you want to use there to mean none, in Congress. This probably means that, based on the population, there are more than just one atheist in Congress. And either they're lying or they've never said that they weren't Christian and people just went with it. I don't know. But either we are living in a world where religious people are capable of getting more power, or there are people who know that they won't get elected if they call themselves atheists, and so they don't bother.
Exactly.
But here's the thing. They made it to Congress. Their constituencies still elected them in. The constituencies saw them as being completely fit to be in Congress and voted for them, not knowing that they were atheists. If there are a few other atheists in Congress, then the only thing that would be disqualifying for them is their lack of religious affiliation. They're in office right now. Apparently, atheism did nothing for their reputation when it's undeclared. Their lack of faith still makes them completely competent in the eyes of their voters.
Surprisingly, even the heathen atheists are able to serve their purpose and do their job well.
Stunningly. So, it seems that while there are still a few states that have constitutions that say that atheists are not allowed to hold office, it's a bit antiquated, and it's not really enforceable. If somebody makes the point, stands up for themselves, in the case that we mentioned, when it gets up to the Supreme Court, obviously that's antithetical to the religious clause of the Constitution, stating that there should be no religious test. And so this probably isn't causing that much of a problem, and we're grateful for that. Nonetheless, we should not have a handful of states in 2017 that have in their oldest documents, in their constitutions, a law prohibiting atheists from holding office. This is troublesome that it was put in the first place, but the fact that it remains and that the battle has yet to come about to remove that language is a bit troubling. And I hope that that the people in those states will talk to their leaders, talk to their government, and say that they want a government that allows for people of any faith or no faith to be seen as competent enough to hold office. We would not stand for this if it was reversed. We would not stand for this if it said that those who have religious faith should be deemed incompetent to hold office. That would be unacceptable. That would be unconstitutional. That is, luckily, fortunately, not the case. To my knowledge, there are no state constitutions that say you're not allowed to hold office if you are, insert theistic group here. It's just the atheists that they seem to be concerned about.
I think it spits in the face of the idea of freedom of religion entirely, that we can say, yes, we're this great country founded on freedom, as long as you believe in a God.
As long as you believe in a God, as long as you are willing to in my view, suspend critical thought and believe in these narratives, as long as you're willing to believe in something. There's a similar rule. This is not really connected, but there's a similar rule in Freemasonry. It doesn't matter what religion you are. They don't discriminate against Jews or Muslims or Buddhists or Christians, but you do have to believe in something. As long as you're willing to suspend some cognition, as long as you're willing to believe in some supreme creator, as long as you're willing to ascribe to some theology, then you're allowed in. We can completely disagree about these gods that are in competition for our beliefs, as long as you believe in something. What we will not stand for is somebody who says none of this makes any sense. In a world where we have thousands of religions, thousands of differing gods, it's pretty obvious that they cannot all be right. And given that they are all unfalsifiable, there is no methodology by which we can determine that one of them is real. You've got apologists in all the major religions all arguing about some trait that their religion has that the other ones don't that makes it more important. But when we apply the outsider test of faith, that is, ask a Christian why they aren't Muslim, ask a Muslim why they aren't Christian, they end up having to go inside their narratives and defend it based on what is said in one holy text or another. It bothers me on a fundamental level that we would determine someone is inferior ideologically or morally or ethically, somebody has a weaker character because they are not willing to believe in any of it. If all religions can't be true, it is quite possible, quite likely even, that none of them are true. You are listening to the Informed Secular Minds podcast. I am here with Maris. You can follow him at YoungAthlon399 on Twitter and Periscope. You can follow myself at Dopinephrine on both of those platforms. You can call us if you want to join the show, 646-564-9551. You can call right into our studio, and we will put you on the air. Okay, I think that we are just about ready to move on to our next subject. I'm having a quick look at the chat. It's difficult to talk and read this at the same time. I'm glad that Zafar is here. We got Arabin, Robert Hamilton. I appreciate everybody who's here. Joel Birch is in here as well. Tiffany, guys, you're amazing. We really appreciate all of your support. We appreciate you guys on social media. We appreciate you listening to the show live and engaging in the chat. It does mean a lot to us, and it helps make the show that much better. Okay. The second main topic for the evening is just a little five-letter word. Not that intimidating. The word is truth. Truth. No word has likely ever proved so troubling or interesting to philosophy. Socrates said, "I know that I know nothing." Conrad Lorenz said, and listen to this, the first time through, it's a little confusing. Conrad Lorenz said, "Philosophers are people who know less and less about more and more until they know nothing about everything. Scientists are people who know more and more about less and less until they know everything about nothing." The point here, it's so good. He's saying so much. It's deafening in its implication. The point here is that the exponential expansion of scientific knowledge means that the more we know, the more there is to know, and therefore, any individual is constantly capable of knowing an ever-shrinking percentage of all knowledge. Specialists must always be chasing new information, and experts are forever a weakening breed. I was having this discussion the other day, and the metaphor that we were using to explore this was a map. Imagine a map with a tiny dot of light in the center. You're in a dark room. You're looking down at a large fold-out atlas, and there's a little dime circle of light right in the middle of the map. Everything else is obscured by darkness. You can study that circle, and over time, you can pretty much know everything there is to know about that circle. depending on the size of the map, that might cover part of a lake and a bit of land. It might cover a couple of blocks inside of a city. It's very, very limited. But especially if you're looking at a city, the implications are enormous. Why does the street go to the edge of the light and just stop? This is how I think about science. There are things that we can empirically demonstrate, and we can then know that that is true, like gravity. Everybody who walks around stays on the ground. It's not like every now and then somebody just floats up and away. That implies something. It implies that there is some kind of natural law that makes it so that it doesn't matter who you are, all of us stay planted to the ground. As science investigates and tries to determine why that is, and begins to look further and further away from their comfort zone, from the innermost point of that light, the light expands, and eventually you can see more and more of the map. The more light there is, the more we're capable of knowing. But that also means that there is a lot more for you to discover. You can't just memorize the little sliver of light any longer. You've got to be able to consider the entire map. If we could illuminate the entire map, no one would be able to know it all. Nobody could memorize the entire map. It would be too big and too complex. So I do like the Conrad Lorenz quote. Now I'm gonna try to get this one out of the way right at the beginning, because it's probably important when we talk about truth, and that is the notion of solipsism. Descartes said, "I think, therefore I am." This was his declaration about the only thing he could know for sure. Everything else, from his point of view, is subject to perception. It changes, it morphs. I could be wrong. My perceptions are limited because I'm relying on my senses. So empiricism is a faulty way of knowing things. Because for all I know, I'm a brain floating in a vat, and all of my experiences are being fed to me through electrical impulses. Descartes, I love and I hate this guy. He's kind of the ultimate troll, the ultimate authority for trolls who take him to be a speaker of truth rather than an abstract thinker of admittedly deserved renown. Descartes moved the goalposts of philosophy so far that we can't bother with anything. If nothing is true, if we can't determine anything as being true except for the fact that we think, therefore, we ourselves exist, then how are we ever – that ends the conversation, doesn't it? There's nowhere to go from there. There's no way to expand upon what he's saying, because anything that is suggested after the fact has to come with the qualification, yeah, but we don't actually know that. It's an interesting philosophical game. It's an interesting thought experiment, but it does very little to help us go anywhere. It does very little to inform how we should proceed in any direction. Descartes also did things like, he invented the X and Y axis that we use in algebra. That's pretty cool. He was a clever guy, a Frenchman. But he's probably most famous for the solipsistic statement, "I think, therefore I am."
I think that's extremely unproductive. Me and you were having a conversation with somebody about this a few weeks ago. It doesn't go anywhere.
Precisely. Well said. So,
we're just brains in jars, or at least I could be a brain in a jar. There's no way to prove that this isn't true. Just as there is no way to prove that it is. In fact, it suggests that in reality, there are, in nothing else, brains and jars. Solipsism is quickly self-defeating, and yet there are those who insist on moving the goalposts for truth to this extreme end. They would say we cannot know that anything is absolutely true because we rely on limited senses as human beings. The problem with this kind of thinking is that it can give license to believing anything you want to with no regard for any standard, because every standard must be suspect. Making this point should not be taken to promote confirmation bias. You can choose to insist that we can know nothing, but you cannot then insist that that means everything is equally untrue. Additionally, proceeding as through a solipsistic worldview is valid in the face of everything our imperfect senses can perceive is fairly reckless. If you are going to impact the world, you have a responsibility to behave as if you are not the only mortal in existence, and that the rest of us also think and therefore exist. So in the off chance that reality exists, we would all do well to recognize each other's rights.
Solipsism, I think, ends up defeating itself fairly easily, but it is one of the harder concepts, not only to get one's head around, but to accurately define. It's very, very challenging. I think that we come up against a significant deficit in language when we begin talking about solipsism. It is hugely fascinating, but I think that it is rather important for us to know when it's time to put that down. I don't think that it's healthy to adhere to a solipsistic worldview in general as we live our lives. We exist in what Richard Dawkins calls middle world. And some of
not
you may have heard
earth.
Me explain this. Not middle earth. Middle world. Yeah, slightly different. Middle world means not the extreme macro and not the extreme micro. Okay, so we can demonstrate that there are things beyond our perception. There are light waves that the human eye can't see. No one's eyes are big enough, nor can they transport themselves to a viewpoint from which you can see the entire universe, yet we're able to look up and to some degree roughly measure it. It's far, far, far too big for us to accurately visualize. The same is true of the incredibly small. We understand molecules. We understand atoms. We can even understand some of the highly theoretical stuff in quantum mechanics like quarks. But we can't inherently understand it as though we are that size. We have to use a microscope at best. We can't just understand what it's like to be on that level. For example, a rock is kind of the definition of something that is solid in middle world. When we consider a rock, we think of it as being very firm. The hardest thing you can get is a rock, unless you get into titanium and stuff like that. In the natural world, if you pick up a rock and you hit something else with it, the thing that isn't a rock is probably going to break. But that's the perception from middle world. If you could shrink down to be the size of a molecule, you would see that a rock is far from solid. Most of the space in matter is just that, space. Most of what you are, most of what anything is empty space. You can't see between the molecules, and indeed they are so tightly woven that other things can't pass through them. This is why a cup holds its liquid. It's the molecules of the water can't just go right between those other molecules. The bonds are too strong in the material. But if you could shrink down to a small enough size, you could pass right through what we perceive as solid objects. That would be little world. I don't know if anybody's read John Ronson's book, The Men Who Stared at Goats. They made a movie of it a few years ago. There was this group of CIA operatives. I think they were CIA. And one of the things, they were testing all of these metaphysical ideas. They were trying to figure out how to use crazy, often pseudoscience, in order to give themselves an edge in battle. And they understood that most of what matter is empty space. So if you look at a wall, most of that wall is empty space. You yourself is mostly empty space. And they thought, well, it should be possible then for us to pass through that wall by just aligning our molecules differently than the molecules of the wall. If we think hard enough, if we could harness the mind over matter concept and arrange our molecules just so, shouldn't we be able to run right through a wall and end up on the other side, having all of our molecules just so miss all of the molecules in the wall? Of course, this never worked. There's a great part of the story where there's a guy who, for the 90th time, is trying this. He's focusing and he's meditating and he's getting all ready, and then he runs full tilt, boom, right into a wall. It doesn't ultimately work, and we understand this.
Unless you're the Flash.
Unless you're the Flash, right, and you'd be able to do it. So ultimately, we exist here in Middle World, where that object must be seen and recognized as solid from our point of view, even if in Little World, on the microscopic level, it's a little bit different than solid the way that we think of solid. This is all to say that if you want to argue about what is true and you're willing to move the goalposts as far as Descartes was, fair enough, I guess. You can't truly, 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 above any shadow of a doubt, know that you actually exist, that you're actually sitting in a room, that I'm actually talking to you on the radio right now. Who's to say that you aren't in the Matrix, being fooled into thinking that all these electrical impulses are actually part of reality and aren't just tricks played on the mind? Okay. But isn't that kind of ridiculous? We've got a lot of evidence to suggest that we as individuals are self-aware, that we are sentient, and that other members of our species should also be sentient. Putting solipsism aside, it's fairly apparent that there are human beings walking around and that they are all subject to the same basic laws of physics. If we exist in Middle World, and it is in Middle World that everything we care about exists, if it is here that we can have objects, that we can love other people, that we can hold our resources, where we can eat and breathe and sleep, that makes Middle World our realm. And to suggest that because we can't know it all, that means we can't know anything, is self-defeating. You're surrendering your own sovereignty when you say that. We exist here in Middle World, regardless of how big the universe could be or how small the micro could be. It's not really important to you as a person. What's important is the Middle World where you actually exist, that which you can actually perceive. That's where your behavior should lie. That's what you should concern yourself with. I believe that we should impact our sphere of influence, however that is defined. And the natural world defines our sphere of influence, among other things, as being relegated to Middle World. So I think it's fair for us to be concerned with what we can empirically demonstrate in this world, in this reality, without the self-defeating, sometimes even nihilistic idea that there is something so much bigger and so much more conceivable that nothing could ever be true and therefore we shouldn't bother. What is true may be relative philosophically, but a Middle World, at the very least, even if Middle World is all a construct of your brain, there are demonstrable material truths. The best way to proceed is to understand the world as it empirically exists for its residents. The news deals in large part with events and statements made on planet Earth by organisms we refer to as Homo sapiens. Since our behavioral reaction to them affects the world as we perceive it, it is surely in our best interest to determine truth to the best of our ability. The turn of the 18th century was at least partially defined by the Industrial Revolution, and the 19th helped define the Industrial Age. A new continent, so to speak, was being explored by the quote-unquote discoverers, and the sudden rush of new resources demanded innovation to reach and collect. In the span of roughly 65 years, the United States went from probing the western reaches of North America with the expedition of Lewis and Clark to connecting the coast with the Transcontinental Railroad. The same period of time led politically and economically to the Second Revolution of the United States in the form of the American Civil War, in which 620,000 soldiers were killed, making it the bloodiest war in American history. The Industrial Age was designed out of need and was intended to create new production and extraction methods that could drive the United States forward economically. Humans mechanized many parts of the world, making labor easier and more productive, and introducing the creeping beginnings of automation. As a byproduct, Americans were capable of producing devastating artillery shells and cannons to fire them. The industrial age was good for resource collecting, and even better for modern, ever deadlier warfare.
At the turn of the 20th century saw a rather different defining evolution. This one was digital, and it led to exponential growth in computer power, proportionally contrasted with a reduction in size that swiftly allowed for personal computers in the homes of citizens. Internet access spread like a wildfire, and inside a generation, Americans went from raising a curious eyebrow at dial-up internet to carrying miniature computers capable of accessing the internet from practically anywhere in the globe. The digital revolution took us from crawling internet browsing displayed on a 30-pound convex monitors to 4G wireless near universal Wi-Fi, loading instantaneously on 4-ounce smartphones in 20 years. And now at the start of 2017, we are solidly at the information age, where technology and machination, yes, has provided our society with the time and access to allow for nearly infinite learning. Any answerable questions can be answered at this point in time.
The natural comparison between the Industrial Revolution leading to factories that could mass produce weapons is the Digital Revolution introducing yet another form of warfare in hacking. It allowed for the United States to destroy a large portion of Iran's nuclear centrifuges with the malicious computer worm Stuxnet in 2010. International characters like Julian Assange and Edward Snowden became household names after publishing or stealing information that was only accessible or transferable because of the networks built after the Industrial Revolution. This, however, is not the comparison we want to make today. We are instead interested in truth in media. I don't want to get into the warfare part of things right now. What I want to talk about is the other great side effect, the other great symptom of the information age. And part of that has to do with access.
Yeah, for most of journalism's history, distributing the news was fairly expensive. It required printing press, delivery system to get small bundles of papers in the hands of readers. Today, anyone with an internet connection could spend 24 hours a day doing nothing but read the news and still never read it all. The industry's changed, and the information age has made disseminating falsified news incredibly easy. It looks like news, reads like news, and with the engine of social media, it's spread like news. There seems to be plenty of people eager to take advantage of this system and present too good to be true content to the eager masses who gleefully snap it up and share it with the increasingly vitriolic world of social media. Partisanship has overtaken truth, and we've entered an age when even a passing glance at social media shows ugly levels of hatred and self-reinforcing lies, all echoing in the groupthink chambers that digital algorithms on Facebook and Google create. But where do these fake news sources start?
Yeah, I'm very interested in that. It should be fairly obvious to everybody that politics has gotten ever more divisive. It's not a new thing. I mean, politics has always been divisive, but it seems like a basic study of American politics suggests that its permeation into culture has reached new heights and has been doing so from election to election, always in one direction. It was around in 2000. That's the first election I can remember actually following. I was 12, I think, and I remember the back and forth of Al Gore and George W. Bush and all of the pundits getting involved. We're just now reaching the 20-year anniversary of MSNBC. I think we just had the 20-year anniversary of Fox News. The 24-hour news cycle is a somewhat new construct. And when you have 24-hour news stations, you always need more information, more content to deliver. If you're trying to fill 24 hours a day, you've got to produce a huge amount of content. And so if something happens, you can end up beating a dead horse, so to speak. How many different ways can we approach a story? How many different opinions can we fit into 24 hours or until something new happens that we can all shift our attention towards? That's the start of things, but that's still cable. What we're talking about is primarily the internet. BuzzFeed did a study. They were investigating teens in the Balkans who began duping Trump supporters with fake news. I'm sourcing BuzzFeed because they did the original article, but you can find plenty of other articles from around the web who talk about the same thing. PRI, for example, has an excellent piece on the exact same story. Quote, "This is the news of the millennium," said the story on worldpoliticus.com. Citing unnamed FBI sources, it claimed Hillary Clinton will be indicted in 2017 for crimes related to her email scandal.
"Your prayers haven't been answered," is the headline here. For Trump supporters, this certainly seemed to be the case. They helped the baseless story generate over 140,000 shares, reactions, and comments on Facebook. Meanwhile, about 6,000 miles away in a small town in the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, a young man, I believe was unnamed, I didn't want to reveal his identity, started watching as money began trickling into his Google AdSense account. Over the past year, the Macedonian town of Veles, population of about 45,000, has experienced a digital gold rush as locals launched at least 140 U.S. politics sites. What are these people in Macedonia, what do they have to do with American government and news? The young Macedonians who run these sites say they don't really care about Donald Trump. They're responding to straightforward economic incentives. As Facebook regularly reveals in earnings reports, a U.S. Facebook user is worth about four times a user outside of the U.S. This fraction of a penny per click of U.S. display advertising, which is a declining market for American publishers, goes a long way in Veles. Several teens and young men who run these sites told BuzzFeed News that they learned the best way to generate traffic is to get their politics stories to spread on Facebook. The best way to generate shares on Facebook is to publish sensationalist and often false content that caters to Trump supporters. As a result, this strange hub of pro-Trump sites in the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia is now playing a significant role in propagating the kind of false and misleading content that has been identified in a BuzzFeed News analysis of hyper-partisan Facebook pages. These sites basically open a window into the economic incentives behind producing misinformation, specifically for the wealthiest advertising markets, and specifically for Facebook, the world's largest social network, as well as an online advertising network such as Google AdSense. Yes, the info in the blogs is bad, false, and misleading, but the rationale is if it gets people to click on and engage, then use it. That was said by a university student in Veles who started a U.S. politics site. This is a guy who agreed to remain nameless.
Their reasons for launching these sites are purely financial, according to the Macedonians with whom BuzzFeed spoke. "I started the site for an easy way to make money," said a 17-year-old who runs a site with four other people. "Most of the posts on these sites are aggregated or completely plagiarized from fringe and right-wing sites in the United States. The Macedonians see a story elsewhere, write a sensationalized headline, and quickly post it to their site. Then they share it on Facebook to try to generate traffic. The more people who click through from Facebook, the more money they earn from ads on their website. Earlier in the year, some in Veles experimented with left-leaning or pro-Bernie Sanders content, but nothing performed as well as Facebook as Trump content. People in America prefer to read news about Trump," said a Macedonian 16-year-old who operates bvanews.com. BuzzFeed News research also found that the most successful stories from these sites were nearly all false or misleading. For example, the most successful post they found from a Macedonian site is based on a story from a fake news website. The headline on the story from conservativestate.com was, Hillary Clinton in 2013, I would like to see people like Donald Trump run for office. They're honest and can't be bought. The post is a week old and has racked up an astounding 480,000 shares, reactions, and comments on Facebook. To put that into perspective, the New York Times exclusive story that revealed Donald Trump declared a $916 million loss on his 1995 income tax returns generated a little more than 175,000 Facebook interactions in a month. The viral Clinton story was sourced from therightist.com, a site that admits it publishes both real and fake content. These people are kids. You got 16 and 17-year-olds who go around to hyperpartisan vitriolic sites, find crazy headlines, stuff that is clearly untrue, repackage it, make it look like news, publish it on their
make
own
it a
website,
little more
their own blogs. Right, make it a little more enticing.
Jazz up the headline.
And then you disseminate that across whatever social media you can. Some of these people have dozens of Facebook accounts just to get the ball rolling. They're figuring out how to trick the algorithms of social networking in order to make fake stories look true. A lot of people who get invested in the hyper-partisan nature of modern politics want their candidate to win. That's obvious. They also want the other candidate to look as bad as possible. That is also obvious. As long as there have been American politics, there have been people trying to make their candidate look better than they actually are and make the other candidate look worse. But this is something fairly new and something that wouldn't be possible, certainly not to this extent, without the digital revolution. In the Washington Post, there was a story that I'm just going to reference quickly. I don't know if you guys remember the Amish lobby story. I don't even remember all the specifics. It was goofy. The idea that the Amish had all decided to vote for Trump and that somehow that would, on a per county basis, swing the election into Donald Trump's favor. Gay wedding vans was another weird story from last year. The ban of the national anthem. I've actually had to argue with people based on this one. The ban of the national anthem. I remember being in the debate, and it was supposed to be a theology debate, but as happens during a heavy political climate like this, politics quickly gets brought up. Even when you're debating, God, or faith beliefs, politics comes up fairly regularly. And this person that I was talking to was convinced, absolutely knew, that President Obama had signed an executive order banning the national anthem. Because Kenya, I don't know.
Why? Who knows?
Nobody knows.
He's Muslim. That's all that matters.
Right. It's just a way to get people to not like Obama. Oh, he's banning the national anthem. Of course, there's absolutely nothing to back that up. But when you see the same stories again and again and again on Facebook.
Yeah, you can't find it from a reputable source anywhere.
That's the key, isn't it? You found it on Facebook.
It's the number one contributor, I think, to the reason that Americans today are so uninformed. This is where they get their news. This is where they get their news, and it's not fact-checked. They read it, and it's just cementing their beliefs that they already have. Because they like this page on Facebook, True Conservative News. You know, of course, they call themselves news. And so the algorithms in Facebook and YouTube and all these social websites just feeds them more and more of it.
Mm.
And they don't need to check anything because all it does is further cement their already what they already believe. So it's easy. It's easy for a lot of people, I think, to just stick to that stuff. They don't want to dig deeper. They don't want to find out if it's true or not because it already aligns with what they think.
Right. It's that echo chamber again. If you start to like stuff that isn't true but is sensational, the algorithms think that's what you want to see because, let's be honest, it is what you want to see. And so they keep giving you this poison. When you kind of like hating the other side, when you kind of like the ridiculous narratives, it's addictive. You want that conversation. You want to be able to hate the other side, the other ideology, the liberals or the conservatives. You want to hate the other group. And the more you indulge in that, the easier it gets. The easier it becomes to believe and be part of the machinery that disseminates this information. And it all ends up going back to a handful of dishonest political operatives or, in some cases, a handful of teenagers in a different country who are trying to make some money. You've got hundreds of thousands of Americans all willing to believe in a story and pass it around, and the entire point of that story existing is either completely falsified so that it's easier to hate the person that you already want to hate, or because a couple of bored teenagers in the Balkans are trying to make money off of AdSense. You are
figured out how to capitalize it.
It's there. You can understand what's happening here, and yet it's okay to go along with it because it feeds that need. It feeds that hyperpartisanship. It feeds that political and cultural sectarianism that we always talk about. That dangerous anything is better than my opponent. In fact, I would rather see my opponent as an enemy than as somebody who just has a different point of view. This is ugly. People need to really start paying attention to what you're reading, and regardless of how much you like how it makes you feel, you should be more concerned with whether or not it is verifiable. So the Amish lobby, the gay wedding bands, and the ban on the national anthem, what do they all have in common? Well, for starters, they're make-believe, but they were also all invented by the same man. Paul Horner is a 38-year-old impresario of a Facebook fake news empire. He's made his living off of viral news hoaxes for several years. He has twice convinced the internet that he's British graffiti artist Banksy. He also published the very viral, very fake news of a Yelp versus South Park lawsuit last year. This is how Facebook's fake news writers make money. In recent months, Horner has found the fake news ecosystem growing more crowded, more political, and vastly more influential. In March, Donald Trump's son, Eric, and his then-campaign manager, Corey Lewandowski, even tweeted links to one of Horner's faux articles. His stories have also appeared as news on Google. The important thing there is that it's becoming more crowded. More people are figuring this out. More people are figuring out that they can make a buck off of this, that If you're getting your money from AdSense, that is to say, the more clicks you get, the more quarter pennies you earn. If you can create something that is so sensational that people will click on it and indeed share it, then that's more eyeballs looking at ads associated with your content, and therefore Google and Facebook and whoever else owes you a tiny, teeny little bit of money. So the point is not to produce interesting content and getting people to honestly come and read it. It's to create something that will go viral. And the things that are most likely to go viral are also the things that are most likely to be untrue. So the money is not in the information age information. The money in the information age, at least in this phase of the information age, is in getting people to believe in bullshit and want that bullshit to be true to the point of suspending critical thought in order to spread this information around the net. There was an interview with a man who did precisely this, who created fake Facebook stories in order to make money off of them. This was his actual job. Like, he just sat at home and used, Photoshop to make articles that looked like news stories and then would send them out into the internet hoping to get ad revenue based on, you know, super angry conservatives sitting at home being willing to share this. And remember, they tried it on the left. They tried doing this in the other direction, and it just never caught. I'm not making any inherent statements about you conservatives out there, but they tried to use this same framework to fool the liberals, and it just never caught fire. It just didn't work. It wasn't a hit. So they went back to, we don't care about Donald Trump. Right. We'll go back to the Trump news. Right.
With Bernie, just didn't work. Am I the only one, Corey, I wonder? This infuriates me. This drives me nuts because I see it every day.
Yeah.
And it seems like in this vitriolic last year and a half that we've had, more so than ever, I think, in American history, are we divided? And everywhere you look, we're not Americans anymore. We're liberals or conservatives.
Right.
We're not on the same team. More so than ever before. And I think that's scary. And I think this goes a long way towards showing just how quickly it can get out of hand. You know, it used to be tabloids and stuff with this ridiculous news. Now it's everywhere you go. I don't even want to get on Facebook. Haven't done so in a long time because it's all shit. And
right.
Everyone shares it. Half the time, they don't even read the article. They still link, you know, this politician is crooked and did this terrible thing. They don't even read it. They don't fact check it. They don't even read the article. They see it. It agrees with how they feel. They post it. And it just spreads like wildfire.
I like what you said about we're not Americans anymore. We're either liberals or conservatives. It's such a false dichotomy. It's such a terrible binary system. And the vitriol, even post the election of Donald Trump, has gotten just so far out of hand. Just the notion that you might be left of center, the notion that you might be a liberal, makes you the other, makes you the lesser, makes you somebody inherently untrustworthy. The idea that you might have different policy positions, that you might look at some data or look at a study or look at a goal for the government and think that you have a good idea of how to go about fixing a problem or increasing the rights of citizens or defending justice, the idea that you go at that from the left, that you have a liberal point of view, that alone makes you disgusting, that makes you horrible, that you should have bad things done to you. You can get on Twitter today and find hundreds of accounts of people who are pro-Trump, presumably. They talk about him enough. And then describe in some detail how much they hate liberals and how much they want to see them harmed, how much they want to see them suffer because they politically lost. This is not how the American conversation has ever gone before. We don't imprison our political opponents. We don't hate one another like this. We shouldn't be this gross about it. And
we're in this together, right?
That's supposed to be the idea when
there used to be a common ground, a compromise between the parties, I feel like.
That's how it's supposed to work. That's how it would be.
Exactly.
We would like it to work. That's how I would like to see it work. When you end up turning everything into liberal versus conservative, when you make everything so goddamn sectarian that you can't see beyond your own extreme partisanship, then you end up deciding that other powers, whatever agrees with you, is better than your opponent. We know that Russia was interfering in our election. We know this. This is factual. Regardless of how they did it, regardless of whether or not it was the government, it doesn't matter. They interfered in the election. Now, if they hadn't and Trump won, fine. They didn't, Trump won, fine. But when we bring it up, I wonder why it is the instinct of the right to side with Russia over the rest of America. Do we no longer believe in sovereignty? Should we not be concerned when foreign powers meddle in our elections? Do we not want a free election? Is it more about winning than it is declaring ourselves free to decide our own destiny? When did we decide that America was subject to political ideology before it was subject to determining its own destiny?
Should we? I know we didn't want to go too far into the presidential race, but I kind of want to read this tweet, Corey, from Mr. Trump.
Please do.
This was 13 hours ago. So Julian Assange said, quote, a 14-year-old could have hacked Podesta, end quote. Why was the DNC so careless? Also said the Russians did not give him the info. My God.
I don't know what the equivalency
they believe it. I don't even – yeah, what do we compare that to?
Okay,
insane.
So the DNC was careless, so it's okay?
Yeah.
I agree. Don't be
so,
so goddamn
okay.
Careless.
Boy. Him and Putin, I tell you. Anyway, let's just go over a few things of to make spotting fake news easier, I guess. One, people let this slip by unnoticed frequently. Check the URL, you guys. You'll see things like abcnews.com.co. That's not abcnews.com, guys. If you find images of things that, oh my God, I can't believe this, drop that image into Google. It's really easy to do on Google. You can just drop the image and search it and see if it is indeed Photoshopped or fake or where the original source, where they got this picture. Another one, I was looking up some browser extensions. There's a couple great ones. Just go into your Chrome extensions and search fake news. And I cannot remember what the name of it was at the moment, but 5-star reviews. It's supposed to live as you're reading pages, be searching and checking if any of this stuff is true that they're claiming. And of course, compare it to reputable sources. If you see a story, Google it. If you're not seeing it on any of the major news networks, there's probably a reason for that because it's not true. Otherwise, you know, why is the rightist saying that this happened and we don't see it on any other major news network or web page or newspaper? So check your sources, guys. Don't spread the lies.
During the campaign, Donald Trump implored supporters in a speech in Colorado Springs to, quote, forget the press, read the internet.
Oh, my God.
Be wary of anyone who is happy to throw out journalism in exchange for the unregulated swamp of hyperpartisan mudslinging. Any individual opinion you would like to find or have reinforced exists somewhere on the internet. Mr. Trump understood that no politician can please everyone, but the echo chamber of the internet can. It's the ultimate source of confirmation bias. How do you source this to just the internet? Anything you could ever want is on there, guys. When he's saying that, he's saying
that he said that he said he read it on the internet after they asked him, what was that?
I don't recall.
It's something ridiculous.
The internet is a tool, not a source. You can't just go to the internet. Come on. There's got to be a higher standard. I'm reminded of the image that you sent me the other day, the screenshot from Facebook. I wish I could send this to you guys visually. I will do my best to describe it. It's a picture, and I got this from Maris. He was good enough to pass it along my way. It's a picture, a rough sketch of a man, one that you might find in like a textbook. It's just an outline of a man, and he's you know, not necessarily anatomically correct. He's just a guy, and in his chest are drawn in red two lungs. And it says, like plus share if Jesus is in your heart. So somebody responded, nice lung picture. And the person who responded, their username is atheism is fake. I don't even know what that means. It says, that's a heart. I do know some science atheists. Very amusing. I do know some, and science is spelled wrong. I do know some science atheists. Very amusing. The guy responded back with, he corrected the spelling of science and said, no, those are lungs. Those are definitely lungs. And Atheism is Fake responded with, this was sent to me from Randy, an admin on Christian forums. I hardly think he wouldn't know a heart from lungs, atheist. Christians 1, atheist 0. Well, as long as we're sourcing this back to Randy, I guess everything we know about anatomy is fundamentally wrong. This okay, first of all, none of this has to do with your, what you're saying is like if you have Jesus in your heart. Great. So, you know, do that. You're just declaring that you believe you have Jesus in your heart. It sounds uncomfortable to me, but a lot of people like to say that. A lot of people, yeah, you know, say that kind of stuff. Fair enough. This other person isn't saying Jesus isn't in your heart. He's saying those are lungs. You don't
just
have to
be. Just
a side
note for that, Corey. I posted the link to that picture in the chat room. I can't post the picture, but the link's there.
Good. Okay. Yeah. So everybody who's listening live, have a peek at that deliciousness. The claim is not about Jesus or his presence in your heart or anything like that. That's completely separate. The issue here, somebody's just pointing out that those are lungs, man. You don't have to be a scientist, you don't have to be an expert to understand the difference between lungs and a heart. They're symmetrical. They're big and they're in the wrong place. That's not a heart. There's two of them. Those are clearly
you
lungs.
Crazy scientists and with your research.
The instinct here was not to say, oh, whoops, isn't that funny? Or to go get, Google, what does a heart look like? Or to check it in any way. The instinct here, and in fact the behavior taken based on that instinct, was to perceive the other person as being an atheist, something that they did not declare. They just said, nice lung picture, is to attack them as an atheist and insist that just because that person is an atheist, they must not know anything about science. Because an atheist is correctly recognizing, identifying the organ as lungs, then they must be wrong. The hyperpartisanship has gotten to a level, at least in this one small anecdotal story, to where you're willing to defend something that is anatomically inaccurate just because. And all that does is dig it deeper. Are you serious? Sometimes you have to just go, whoops, I made a boner, and move on. But no, you're going to double down and try to actually declare that lungs are a heart just because you want to be right. One wonders if there is a correlation between the willingness to believe fake news and the overwhelming and reinforced urge across society to employ faith in God beliefs. As we have discussed, the overwhelming majority of Americans still believe in some kind of deity, and most of them declare that they know the truth of reality through theology. They often hold the contradictory and disproven narratives found in the Bible as true rather than as myth, allegory, or metaphor. Creationists employ the same tactics as the teenagers in the Balkans to promote everything from anti-science to faith beliefs to the Ark Encounter in Kentucky. They refuse to separate their spiritual truth from evidence. A desire to believe in God all too often encourages people of all walks of life to perceive the world inside a narrative in which the only absolute fact is that God is real, and therefore any discovery, any new information, any level of empiricism is either suspect and discounted or twisted into evidence for one of the various gods that mankind has postulated. Religion in many ways has become politicized, And so legislative questions and opinions end up being informed first and foremost by theology.
Solipsism aside, we should all be able to agree that there are humans on the planet Earth. They are often grouped into cultures and societies. Societies in modern times tend to organize into political structures in order to govern. Governance is a system used to define and enforce the rules by which constituents operate and how they treat each other in order to defend rights and justice. If you agree that all of these things are true, then hopefully you will also agree that the constituents should have the ability to know what their governments are doing. A reliable way to go about this, given that no individual can be in more than one place at a time, is to employ journalists who serve as witnesses to events or record the statements made by figures and then spread the information out to a constituent audience. In order to avoid obvious conflicts of interest, it's a good idea for journalism to be separate from the government and as unbiased as possible. This realization occurred to the Founding Fathers, who enshrined it in the Bill of Rights, right there in the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment.
The First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution states, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances." It's right in the First Amendment. We understand that it is important for us to be able to shine a light on what our representatives are doing. If you've got a better system of doing that than using journalists, first, let us know, because we're fascinated in that kind of shit. Second, go start a business and do it. If you can come up with a better method than journalism, then do us all a favor and give it to us. But so far, journalism is the best system we've come up with for determining what is true when it comes to our governing body. This is sometimes referred to as the fourth estate or the fourth branch of government, whatever. The point is, you can have the government. You can have democracy even. That's great. But if you don't know what's going on, if you're not capable of physically being there to keep an eye on these people, then how would you know if they're infringing on your rights? Until it's too late.
Exactly.
We need an informed electorate. We desperately need an informed electorate. And in the information age, we should have one. But what we have demonstrated here is that a small group of people can make up whatever bullshit they want. And y'all gonna read it and take it as true and send it to your aunts and your grandkids and your spouse and your brothers and sisters and try to get them to all believe it is true. You're going to go and you're going to have a discussion about what candidates to support. And the last thing you're going to be interested in is policy differences. I was talking to a guy, and this is couple months ago now, and we were discussing little differences. We were debating the path that we would like to see our shared country take. And his number one concern in 2016 was transgender people using bathrooms.
Ooh, hot button issue.
Now, who am I to decide what should be most important to another citizen? If that is what you perceive as affecting you the most, then there's little I can do but respect that. If that's your number one concern, if you think that whether or not it's legal or not for transgender individuals to pee, if that's more important to you than the economy, than jobs and foreign policy, than whether or not we should go to war, than what we should do about ISIS, than how we should approach Syria, what we should do about China. Okay. I asked this person several times, is this really your number one concern? Yes, it is. Number two is gun rights. At least that's a little bit, you know, substantial. At least there are actually some issues there. But first and foremost, this guy was interested in transgender issues. So I agreed to debate him on this point, and we talked for a while. And this was also his number one reason for not voting for Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton, according to this person, wanted more transgender people to be allowed to go to the bathroom, and so he perceived that as endangering his children, that surely this would lead to a massive spike in molestation in public restrooms.
Because, of course, being transgender is a prerequisite for, you know, they're highly more predisposed to be rapists and child molesters.
Every single bit of evidence that we have suggests precisely the opposite. And when I pushed this person on that point, I did eventually get them to where they were able to boil this down to, well, I don't trust them because they're obvious deviants, because the Bible tells me so.
And that's what same issue as the gays. Who doesn't want gay rights? Christians.
Some Christians. The concern.
The ones that are following their doctrine correctly.
Right. Anybody who's following the doctrine must be anti-gay, or else have a very, very interesting interpretation of the Bible. And I'm all for that. But I wonder how far you can bend your interpretation of the Bible before you no longer believe that it's the perfect word of God. If it's the perfect word of God and you interpret statements to mean their actual opposites, well, did God mess up, or are you messing up in your interpretation? I don't know how they avoid that question. In any case, this person was ignoring the plethora of studies that show that molestations, child rape even, do not happen at larger numbers among transgender people, do not happen in higher numbers among homosexuals. They were sourcing this all the way back to a 2,000-year-old series of books written by some desert dwellers who didn't like gay people, thought it was gross, and so they were appealing to their perceived moral authority to say that that being a transgender person is bad. We expounded on this a little bit, and this person decided, because I was providing all these sources, that he would do the same and that he would provide me with some sources. And he sent me, to the magical land of InfoWars. The magical world of Alex Jones. It might be, it's a little old now, but it might be the all-time champion of fake news. He took me to a series of articles, in fact, because you shouldn't just trust one source, he was willing to admit. He sent me to several sources that explained in some detail that not just Hillary Clinton, but the current president, Barack Obama, are both, and I am not exaggerating here, are both resurrected corpses from hell. This person believed that Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton are technically dead, but they are inhabited by demons, by supernatural spirits from another dimension, who animated their corpses in order to dominate mankind under the authority of Satan. This was backed up by mountains of evidence, as you can imagine. Have you ever noticed that flies are attracted to Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton? This is because they are made of decaying flesh. There were several pictures of the president with a fly in his general vicinity. And this was presented as empirical proof that the president of the United States is a zombie. I don't know about you guys. I have on occasion had a housefly get in my home. And they like to land on you. It's annoying as shit. I didn't even find it necessary to go to a lab and test to see whether or not I was actually dead. Flies land on people. It's not that weird. This expounded from that point as I was struggling to reorganize my thoughts into absolute proof, also from Mr. Jones, or his I don't know what you call it, network from his company, from InfoWars, that Hillary Clinton, much like her husband Bill, is a sex fanatic who is only attracted to young children and who often engages in satanic, demonic rituals that involve strange mixture. I'm sure there's a recipe book somewhere, combinations of blood and semen and urine, and you bathe children in this and it builds power from the demon world. And then when you rape that child, the power is transferred to you. And they do this in order to continue their grand mission. Thank God. Thank God Almighty that Donald Trump, the only living candidate, was successful, that the people rebelled against the zombie demons of hell and got him elected. There's nothing wrong with voting for Donald Trump if you believe that he is the best candidate for policy, if you believe that he is the best person to lead this country forward. But in the information age, post-digital revolution, we should not have groups of people in the United States who are perfectly willing to look you in the eye and suggest that the president of the United States is part of a demonic cult that can only succeed through the rape of children. Who believes this? Who reads that and goes, I knew it, that's why I'm voting for Donald Trump? What is wrong with you? It is more important to know what is true than it is to know what agrees with what you want to be true.
Ooh, say that again.
It is more important to know what is true than it is to know what agrees with what you want to be true. We all have a narrative. We all have the way that we would like things to be. We all have dreams and desires. Those of us who are politically active want the future to look a certain way. We want to urge society to move in one direction or another, whether towards traditionalism or through progressivism. We want to see change occur in our legislation, in our attitudes, in our discourse. What we don't want is people who are willing to make their decisions based on a belief that there are supernatural powers at work, from hell no less, that are trying to control us. You know, I remember the old days, like 5 years ago, when the weirdest shit was the Illuminati. When the strangest ideas were about aliens that had landed thousands of years ago and impregnated Earth women and created a super race of reptiles who could be traced through their bloodline all the way through the ancient Egyptian pharaohs to Beethoven, to the Queen of England, to the presidents of the United States, all of them. Anybody should be able to read that and go, nope. But it is again and again presented as truth. You have got to be able to distinguish between the truly obscene, the truly ridiculous, and that which can be verified. If you are willing to believe anything, it's not that big of a leap to being willing to do anything based on those beliefs. In the end, and as an atheist, I myself insist that since we cannot know that God is real, we are better off not investing or indeed in some cases sacrificing our lives, pleasures, cognitive consistency, or our very future, and in my assessment, rare or not, all too often our children's future too, in the name of mortal knowledge illuminating a specific interpretation of a particular narrative of a conscious, personal, interfering God whose very nature is proclaimed to be unknowable. That, after all, is a ridiculous notion, and is in direct competition with thousands of other deity beliefs, each falling far shy of satisfactory evidence. What I do not say is that there is no God. I'm no more convinced of a supreme creator of the universe than I am of the great forest spirit, or crop curses from jealous witches, or reincarnation in the body of some other animal or person. These ideas have the same burden of proof, fall woefully short of it, and are being or have been taken as truth by reasonably substantial cultures. These claims are backed merely by tradition and the inability to disprove them. Were animistic beliefs less real to their adherents than the salvation of Christ is to believers of a different culture today? Surely not. Spirituality has a way of internally allowing for a broader framework through which human intimations are explained by faith, much like scientific observations are explained by theory. When we fail to find consistency, or when we strive to explain more than we ought, it is natural to reach for ethereal explanations that account for more than we can know. By all means, employ this for yourself if you like. I find that faith rests on ground a bit too shaky for me. But twisting definitions or reducing the knowable to just more beliefs grounded by nothing in the interest of philosophical inclusiveness or in order to account for the widespread contradicting ramblings of our species is not the same as enlightenment. In fact, it's chaotic. If you insist on allowing for anything or everything to be true, then you reduce truth to the most common thing in the universe.
A similar problem arises when the doubter or skeptic is put on intellectual trial. He's commended to prove the claim in question is not true. When he fails to empirically negate unfalsifiable claims, it's taken as further proof of the claim's validity. Can you imagine if this slobbering excuse for thought was employed with any other assertions? It suggests that failure to disprove exceptional statements must lead to a default acceptance of anything. You don't think I can fly? Prove it, or I don't believe it. Prove that my dog can't operate a drum machine and two turntables. Prove that the Prophet Muhammad didn't fly into heaven on a supernatural steed. Of course, as we all know, the burden of proof relies on the claimant, not the doubter. And as we've demonstrated on the show previously, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence.
Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence.
Love the quote.
The lack of being able to prove something doesn't mean that nothing is provable. When Nathaniel was on the show at the beginning of our first Nativity episode, we talked about six levels of extraordinary claim, six levels of claim, rather, and getting more extraordinary as we went. If something sounds too good to be true, it probably is. And guess what? In the information age, you can test it. If Uncle Jimmy sends you a story that makes your political opponent an absolute monster that nobody should listen to, it's pretty goddamn tempting to believe that shit. But how fortunate you must be to have access to this information. Out of everyone, somebody figured out this remarkable thing. Somebody out there knows that the person you don't want to be president is having sex with children. Nobody would vote for that person. Therefore, you very much want it to be true because you don't want anybody to vote for that person. But look at what they're saying. It's ridiculous. It's an extraordinary claim. It's absurd. You cannot just believe in shit because it happens to agree with you. If it agrees with you and it's true, awesome. Proceed. Use that as ammunition when you are fighting an opponent. But don't just take stuff and run with it and disseminate it when it's obviously false. The more extreme and crazy a claim is, the more you should go, hang on a second, before I just click share, I'm going to check this. Is there such a thing as people that can be resurrected from the dead by Satan? No? Then probably the president isn't one of them. In the information age, skepticism is needed more than ever. There are people who want you to think that their chosen political leader is the most trustworthy, most smart, most tremendous leader of all time. There are people that want you to think that anyone else is lying, child-molesting, reincarnated lunatics from hell. There are people who would have you believe that Sharia law is about to be declared in the United States, or the earth is flat, or there is a lake of fire where you will burn forever and ever if you have sex with someone their book says you should not. Be skeptical of claims like these. Follow up with critical thought and additional sources. Consider whether the claim being made is falsifiable or not. Consider what the person making the claim has to gain by getting your belief, and proceed with care. Be responsible for what you share. Impact your sphere of influence with respect and honesty. Prize truth above victory. Never stop being inquisitive. Never sacrifice your right to critical thought, and never stop thinking. Well, this has been the Informed Secular Minds podcast, and we thank each and every one of you for tuning in. We're going to do the show every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Central Time, 6 o'clock Mountain, 8 o'clock on the East Coast. Do the math if you live somewhere else. This week we had Maris with us. You can follow him on Twitter and Periscope at YoungAthlon399. He does some fantastic atheist scopes. I really encourage everybody to follow him. Give him some hearts. Give him some support when he is broadcasting live. You can follow me, Corey, at Dopinephrine. That's Dopinephrine on Twitter or on Periscope. Send me an email if you like, dopinephrine@gmail.com. You can follow our show, ISM_podcast, on Twitter and on Periscope. For future broadcasts, you can listen to the show at blogtalkradio.com/informedpodcast. You can also subscribe on iTunes, where you can get the show at Informed Secular Minds. We really appreciate you guys being with us tonight. It is always a pleasure and a privilege to have you with us. We again want to wish Nathaniel the best as he moves forward with his next project. Everybody, thanks for being here.
Yeah, we do.